A lot of news breaking. And a lot of it is very good for the president of the United States. So the best piece of news for the president of the United States is that he went to the tarmac to greet a bunch of North Korean prisoners who had been released. It was three North Korean prisoners rather than five. Three North Korean prisoners who had been released. They were American citizens. And here is what it looked like when the president of the United States greeted them on the tarmac at Joint Base, at the Joint Air Force Base in Andrews, in the Andrews Air Force Base in Maryland. Okay, so you can just see him greeting these guys as they get off the plane. And it is, in fact, a pretty amazing thing. Now, Trump went on, he talked to the press, he did what Trump always does, right? And it's just the best of Trump, right? So Trump gets these guys out, right? I mean, these guys are released, they come back. Trump says now that he's going to meet directly with Kim Jong-un on June 12th. So that is coming up in the very near future. And we'll have to keep an eye on that, obviously. We don't know how those negotiations are going to go, but all of these guys thanked President Trump for getting them out. Trump then proceeded to go out there and brag about the ratings that he was getting at 2 a.m. and talk about how they'd been treated excellently by the North Koreans, which, of course, is not really true. But here's the thing. I think the American public have learned to separate out the Trumpy from the good stuff that he's doing. I think that the longer Trump's presidency goes on, the less people are worried as much about the kind of crazed nature of the Trump presidency, and the more they're looking at the policy, because right now the economy is doing very well. Instead of trading five terrorists for Bo Bergdahl, a traitor, instead the president of the United States traded no terrorists for three Americans in North Korea, and ISIS, five top ISIS leaders were just captured in Iraq. So President Trump tweeted on Thursday that five of the most wanted ISIS leaders had been captured. Spokesman for Operation Inherent Resolve, Army Colonel Ryan Dillon tweeted on Thursday that Iraq captured five key ISIS leaders as part of Operation Roundup. And the tweet didn't specify when or where the five were captured. It didn't give any names. Dillon's tweet said the capture was a coordinated operation between Iraqi and U.S.-backed Syrian Democratic Forces. So those would be the same people who are helping fight Assad. Iraq captures five key Daesh leaders. Daesh is the Arabic name for ISIS. During Operation Roundup, the arrest is a significant blow to Daesh and demonstrates close coordination between ISF, SDF in their fight to defeat Daesh. And then they say that the joint force is committed to lasting defeat of Daesh and setting conditions for stabilization. Okay, so all of this is very, very good news for President Trump. All he has to do, apparently, is just ignore everything Obama would have done and everything goes swimmingly. So all of that is excellent news for the president of the United States, who, again, instead of trading five terrorists for a traitor, just captured five terrorists along with the Iraqis and the Syrians and freed three Americans. So well done, President Trump. Meanwhile, the president is doing the right thing in the Middle East as well. Iran had attacked Israel with a bunch of missiles, a bunch of rockets from Syria into the Golan Heights. The Golan Heights is a portion of Israel that was captured originally from Syria during the 1973 war, I believe, was the Golan Heights. The 73 war. The Golan Heights is a very strong strategic point in Israel. It's a section of Israel that is elevated by about 300 feet up almost a straight cliff that overlooks Israel. When Syria owned it, Syria used to use it as a staging point for attacks. Israel owns it now, and Syria has been very upset about that ever since. Well, the Syrian government, which is working in cahoots with the Iranians, they fired a bunch of rockets at the Golan Heights. Israel has this amazing defense system, this amazing rocket defense system. They shot down all 20 of them, and then Israel proceeded to pound the living crap out of a bunch of Syrian targets that had Iranians on them. So Israel's intelligence is good enough that Israel knows where Iran is stationing its people in Syria. And Israel went in and killed, I believe, 28 Iranians who were members of the Iranian military in Syria. They're pounding Syria. And what they said, and I love this line, they said, if it rains in Israel, it will pour in Iran. Meaning, you try anything and we will make you bleed. And it's an amazing thing because all of the people who have been victimized by the Assad regime in Syria, apparently there were reports that they were cheering as Israeli warplanes, as Jewish warplanes were flying into Syria. A bunch of Muslims were cheering that Israel was coming in, which is not a shock because, again, the enemy of my enemy is my friend in the Middle East. And right now it is very obvious who the friends are, right? Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, Egypt, Jordan, Israel. They're all on one side against the Iranians. And as I've been saying for a long time here, the reality is that the only thing that Obama's Iran deal achieved was the creation of this alliance. So in a weird way, Obama actually facilitated the creation of an anti-Iranian alliance that is very powerful and I think is going to hold up for a long time. I think that's really good. That's actually a really good thing that happened unintentionally because Obama never did anything great intentionally. He did something really great unintentionally by strengthening Iran. He forced all of these other countries to jump in the sack with Israel, and now all of them are allied against the Iranian power. That's a really good thing. The UAE said that it was good that Israel had struck these Iranian targets last night. They said Israel has a right to defend itself. The United Arab Emirates said that the Jewish state, which I'm not even sure that they formally recognize, has a right to defend itself. The Saudis said the same thing. And it's an amazing, amazing thing. And the Trump administration said all the right things as well. Unlike the Obama administration, which always called for restraint whenever Israel was attacked, the Trump administration said, listen, you get hit, you do what you want, right? Israel has every right to defend itself. Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you to the Trump administration for saying the right thing. So here's the story from the UK Sun. Israel has blasted Iran's bases in Syria with 70 missiles, killing at least 23 fighters in revenge for rocket strikes on the Golan Heights. Fighter jets bombarded military bases, munitions warehouse, and intelligence centers after Tel Aviv stoked fears of a war by warning if it rains in Israel, it will pour in Iran. I'm sorry, I love the British media coverage there, that Israel stoked fears of a war. Israel didn't initiate the conflict. Israel was attacked by rockets, and then Israel threatened in response that if you keep firing missiles at us, we're going to kick your ass. That's fine. That's good. That's not Israel threatening a war. That's Iran threatening a war, and Israel saying, if you start it, we will finish it. Which, by the way, is exactly what you should teach your children when it comes to fights. Never start a fight, but if you get in a fight, finish the fight. The strikes hit nearly every target and were a response to 20 rockets fired by the Iranian Quds Force, Israeli military chiefs claimed. Five Syrian soldiers, including two officers and 18 militia fighters, were killed in the attack, according to the Britain-based Syrian Observatory for Human Rights. The death toll is likely to rise because some of the wounded are in critical condition. As I said, I believe that the actual number is about 28 at this point. The conflict came hours after President Trump pulled out of the nuke deal with Iran. Now, one of the things that's amazing about all of this is that the entire left is now blaming Trump for Iran attacking Israel. They're suggesting that it's Trump's pullout from the Iran deal that emboldens the Iranians to pursue nuclear weapons. This is the essence of stupidity. It is such a bad argument. The argument, I guess, is that Iran was moderating. They were doing fine. They were moderating. And then Trump came along. Then Trump came along and he did something super duper terrible. He pulled out of this Iran deal. And now everything has gone to hell in a handbasket. Now look at what he's done. He's created a war in the Middle East because he pulled out of the Iran deal. And the reality is that the Iran deal was going to end with Iran having nuclear weapons. It was never designed to prevent Iran from getting nuclear weapons. It was designed to kick the can down the road to ensure that the next president would have to own anything that went wrong in Iran. That's where all of this was going. And here's the proof. Okay, there is no nuclear deal that has ever been cut with an extremist group to remove them of nuclear weapons. Never in history with bribery. It doesn't work that way. There are very few nations in the history of the world that have actually had nuclear weapons and then given up the nuclear weapons or been developing a nuclear program and then stopped developing the nuclear program. You can actually list them on slightly more than one hand, right? Ukraine had nuclear weapons, but those were left over from the USSR. Kazakhstan had nuclear weapons. Those were left over from the USSR. Belarus had nuclear weapons. Those were left over from the USSR. The United States came in and said, listen, you guys don't have the capacity to take care of your nuclear weapons or secure your nuclear weapons, so you should give those up. And in return, we'll give you security guarantees. That's worked out pretty well up until Obama, who allowed Russia to invade Ukraine and annex Crimea. The only two nations that actually developed nuclear weapons or were in the process of developing nuclear weapons and gave them up were South Africa in 1993 and Libya in 2003, right? Those are the only two nations that had active nuclear programs who gave up their nuclear weapons and just said no. Okay, and the reasons they gave up those nuclear weapons were not because the United States came to them and said, we will bribe you to give up your nuclear weapons. The reason they gave up their nuclear weapons is that those countries preemptively gave up their nuclear weapons, knowing that there would be consequences if they did not. In other words, the countries themselves moderated. So South Africa in 1993, under F.W. de Klerk, right, he came forward and he said, listen, we have six nuclear weapons. Those six nuclear weapons, we just gave those up. And we had those that were created in the 1970s and the 1980s as a counterbalance to USSR influence in Africa. We don't need those anymore. And in order to demonstrate to the world that we are intent on being peaceful, I'm going to give up those nuclear weapons right now, right? In expectation that the world would then treat them better, right? It was an investment by South Africa in their own future. The same thing happened with Muammar Gaddafi. Now, it turns out the Obama administration proceeded to take him out anyway, which was the wrong move, as I said at the time. Okay, the Gaddafi in 2003 apparently got a letter from George W. Bush, and the letter said, give up your nukes or we're coming after you. And Gaddafi said, all right, sounds good. He saw the United States was about to go into Iraq. And before the United States went into Iraq, he gave up his nuclear weapons because he figured, I don't want to go to war with these people. I want to be seen as moderate. And so I'm going to preemptively give up my nuclear weapons. Hey, this is the reality. If Iran wanted to give up its nukes, if Iran wanted an open economy, you know how they could do that? You know how they could have a peaceful exchange with the rest of the world? They could just stop their nuclear program now without any deal. They could just say, listen, we've destroyed all of our nuclear facilities. We're done. Now open up. Rest of the world, help us out. And you know what would happen? Everything would be hunky-dory. But they have no intention of doing that. And I have the proof for you in just a second. First, I want to say thanks to our sponsors over at Skillshare. So you need to make your resume better. You do. Your resume is good. It's fine. I mean, I'm not ripping.